as I command. Aye, folks. Kilt-Man here, Kilt-Man, and Kentucky Fudge, here again at your service. How are you all? Hope you're doing very, very well. Now, I did a video on Flash Gordon, Sam J. Jones, Max von Sydow, Topol, Randy Anderson, Brian Blessed, the 1980 Dino De Laurenti Flash Gordon, and I said in that video that I've barely scratched the surface of it. And of course, I barely even did that. There's so much more to discuss about this lavish production. So many different things we could go into. Like the fact that I completely got the name wrong of the guy who plays Clytus. It's not Patrick Wingard. I must be thinking of Patrick Widmark. It's Peter Wingard. And it's doubly annoying that I got that name wrong because I'm a massive fan of Peter Wingard. Jason King, Department S, one of the most flamboyant and very arrogant, egocentric performers. Bit controversial as well, but we won't go into that side of things. And I think he's a wonderful, wonderful actor. And to get his name wrong, it's actually annoyed the hell out of me. Because I said about him wearing a mask, it's one thing. At least, you know, he's got a very character-filled face, which is just iconic. But his voice carries it. So you may have masked the face, but the voice is still there. And he was well known for Jack Clayton's The Innocents, where he's barely even in it, playing the vengeful groundsman who leans in at the window, and with his aquiline sort of Roman nose, that very pinched angular face and his piercing eyes. He always reminds me of the equally British actor Simon McCorkindale, only he's got much better hair than Simon McCorkindale ever had. But, and he's great in Flash Gordon. But anyway. So I've corrected that mistake now. Duh. But the music itself, there's a lot more to say about the music. Although I always bang on about, you know, Howard Blake being the guy who did the orchestral soundtrack to the movie right alongside Queen. The fact is, the score was always meant to be done by a band. Now initially, director Mike Hodges wanted Pink Floyd to do it, but couldn't get them. So Queen stepped in, and Queen had a huge amount of power. Don't forget, they were riding the crest of the wave, late 70s and into the 80s. And these were like, you know, big concert, you know, superstars, massive concept albums. They were huge, huge. They were so huge that Dino De Laurenti didn't really know them. So look, who is this band, the Queens? I don't know why I gave them that accent. It's Italian. But, he listened to some of their stuff and he was like, well, he's not into rock music, but hey, it'll work somehow. To be honest, he didn't like what he heard. And when he was hearing what they were coming up with for certain scenes, they were shown rough cuts, they were shown bits of footage, and they were, Freddie was crooning away, Brian May was coming up with lots of great melodies, and of course Roger Taylor was coming out with some great percussive bass lines. But when Dino heard it, he was obviously frowning and no, this isn't working. But because the whole project, the whole production was day by day veering right off the rails, it was going that side of the rails, then that side of the rails, it was never actually on the rails. But because of all these other hassles, Sam J. Jones picking fights with all and sundry, getting his face bashed in and having to get his scars patched up for the next day's filming, lots of stuff going on. The script getting changed, everything getting changed every single day. But it was the least of Dino's worries. So in the end, he just capitulated. Yeah, go on, whatever, do whatever. Ciao, I'm out of here. And so they got full free range. But Queen already had another composer to do the symphonic orchestral blended background as well. They had their themes, they had their ideas, but they needed stuff. They'd never done an underscore to a movie before. Obviously, rock bands and musicians, you know, pop musicians had done movie soundtracks, but they'd never done the actual underscore as well. They'd supplied songs, but not specifically written for a movie and an underscore as well. So they had a composer who lasted one day with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. So they had 1 minute's worth of music and a very tight schedule to get the score done. So they then turned to Howard Blake. Howard Blake, who'd been sort of mentored by the great Bernard Herrmann and highly inspired by him. He came on board and said, I'm going to need a lot longer than, you know, they gave him like literally a couple of weeks to get the work done. Sorry, 4 days. 4 days to get the score done. He said, you want 90 minutes worth of music? I want 4 weeks. In the end, that got haggled down to about 10 days. And at the end of that 10-day run, he'd put himself into such a, he wasn't sleeping, Howard Blake, working round the clock to get all this work done, composing, writing, and then orchestrating, and then obviously, you know, recording it all, that he put himself into a state of absolute bronchial downtime and was hospitalised, had to be given injections to bring him back to life. The doctor actually said, apparently, when he found him crashed out, that if I hadn't injected him, he would never have come round. Stress brought on a bronchial infection. So, people that are suffer for their art, don't they? And in fact, speaking of suffering for their art, you might not realise it, but Kilt-Man is actually very unwell at the moment. I've had a few days of suffering with a bug, and because you may have heard, there's a bug going round. Yeah, yeah, just one. One big one. There was 18 other ones, but it's this 19th one we've got to worry about. No, it's not that. Hopefully I'm getting out of it. But if I seem a little sort of lackluster, now you know why. But so he worked with Brian May extensively, and he worked with Freddie Mercury. He would come out with some great high falsetto melodies and tunes, which he would go, okay, I can write to that. So the soundtrack album and the movie itself is primarily Queen's music. It's what they came up with, the themes, the anthems, the pounding rock for the attack on their war rocket Ajax. That's all Queen. But to give it a wider feel, Howard Blake obviously added more orchestral elements to things. Queen were using synthesizers extensively as well, because that was all the rage at the time. And of course, it adds a huge sci-fi angle, you know, to any kind of soundtrack. It's essential to depict otherworldly dimensions and spectral, magical, cosmic happenings. It's just, it's part of the genre. So they had a lot of that going on. And then, obviously, Howard Blake and a full orchestra, an 80-strong orchestra, literally producing powerhouse themes and beautiful, romantic, lush, lyrical sequences, especially for the flight to Arborea, where the duplicitous renegade daughter of Ming, Princess Aura, Onelamuti, is trying to seduce Flash, of course, and he's demanding telepathic powers to speak to Dale, see if he's still alive. But that is one hell of a lush theme as they're going through the swirling cosmos and clouds, through all the various fractured moons around Mongo. And it's wonderful stuff. But that is actually Freddie Mercury came up with most of that, believe it or not. And Queen, that is Queen's music, but Howard Blake would embellish it with a full orchestral background to give it even more depth and more resonance. And man, it works so well. There's some really lush, romantic elements to the score, which people often will forget about because they're just thinking of Flash, all this stuff, like, and the pounding rock elements, which of course they are, they're the standout elements. But what Howard Blake produced as well works totally well, totally in mesh and in sync. When he was orchestrating and conducting the orchestra, he'd hear Brian May on lead guitars on his earphones, and he'd be conducting the orchestra as well. So the whole thing was worked out together. There may have been Queen as being the driving force, but Howard Blake provided that spectral cosmic icing on the cake. Now, sadly for Howard Blake, is that in the film itself, the finished film, there's not a great deal of his individual music there. Some of his great tracks are there. So to really experience what Howard Blake came with, you've really got to try and find his album, his score album to the movie, which I have various versions. And, you know, inevitably you get dialogue on these things, which you're hearing crooning away. We're in Ming's throne room now, but we're going to get to the flight to Arborea. And this This is Howard Blake embellishing the theme that Freddie Mercury had just literally spared the moment, just crooned, you know. But Howard Blake and Brian May would work very well together. They would listen to little recordings on Howard Blake's sons, because they had no sound systems. Unbelievably, for a composer and for a leading rock musician, both had their equipment was getting fixed or getting done up. One was moving house, so they had no stuff. So during this time, they would have to resort to using a little tiny cassette player, which Howard Blake had bought for his son, with a little cable like that long to plug it in. And the two of them would have to listen, sharing earphones, to what Brian May had just come up with on guitar, his tunes, his compositions, which Howard Blake would then interweave into the score that he was creating around. You know, you've got to love and admire people like this, that for a creative vision, they'll do anything, working around the clock, using completely inappropriate equipment just to get the point across, but you could still hear the essence of what was necessary, the tune, the motif. I mean, I'm talking over it now. But this is beautiful, this. Spellbinding and spectral. Kind of wish that maybe some of the antics in Princess Aura's little pleasure craft didn't take so much precedence, just to watch that ship drifting through those, you know, rainbow-coloured cosmic clouds. Listen to this. Here, you can hear Bernard Herrmann. You can also hear Christopher Young, the great Christopher Young, who had composed for Hellraiser, Drag Me to Hell, Species, Fly 2. It was very sombre, brooding, but also lushly romantic, tragic sort of themes, all woven beautifully together. Listen to this. It's magical, isn't it? So there's a lot, and there's a lot more action as well, because obviously with the whole thing with the tree stump on Arboria, putting your hand in, oh, a bit of a Russian roulette with that one. Oh, I ain't doing it. By the way, Baron Timothy Dalton really is a fool. To have fallen to Sam J. Jones is, I'd be like, show me the wound. Show me the wound. Come on, you've come back from the dead once already. I'm not falling for this one. Come on, show me that wound. Oh, shit, you got me. In his overdubbed voice. I also neglected to mention that one of Prince Vultan, Brian Blessed, who, by the way, in the initial series, he's called Prince Vulcan. You can understand why they changed that. You know, Alex Raymond, who created Flash Gordon, it was Prince Vulcan. With another very famous Vulcan on the sci-fi, you know, bandwidth. You couldn't really be having that, could you? So he became Vultan. And but one of his hench hawkmen is played by the great John Hallam. John Hallam plays the evil brute in Dragon Slayer, which would come out, I think, the following year for Disney, one of Disney's darkest hours. And he's great in that. And he has a very chiseled face. He's a very theatrical actor as well. And all these guys, the Hawkmen, all strutting about wearing not much other than great big bronze wings, which, by the way, they couldn't take them off. So all the days of shooting, the long, long days of shooting with the Wingmen. The Wingmen? The Hawkmen. They couldn't sit down. They'd have to lie on their stomachs, because they could not sit down. These wings were just too big, too enormous, too weighted. You couldn't get comfortable, you couldn't sit down. So they'd be lying on their stomachs. Melody Anderson always said it looked ridiculous seeing all these hundreds of guys just lying on the floor on their bellies. Like they'd all been downed, you know, an entire flock had been shot down. But yeah, Brian Blessed. Now, he always boasts about how much he can bench press. Now this is a guy in his, what, 70s now, late 70s. He's climbed Everest several times. You know, he's been theater, stage, TV for decades and decades. He's been in every genre. He's a full Shakespearean actor and a bit of a lovey darling as well, but he's fabulous. A fabulous, you know, God, thank you for putting Brian Blessed on this planet. But he's huge. You know, you look at his legs, you look at his arms. He might not be Stallone or Arnie defined, but they are pretty meaty, you know, slabs of pure muscle that he's got there. You know, you wouldn't want to tangle with him. And that beard and that ridiculous helmet, which is what that modeled on the helmet the original Prince Vulcan wore. But he's terrific, isn't he? You know, although to have built what is already a fabulous career, spanning lots of TV shows, lots of theatrical productions, to then base most of your career after 1980 on this, I'm still a bit like, you know, you are better than this, Brian, you are. But his anecdotes make the movie, don't they? You know, when he, you know, he always is, they lure War Rocket Ajax through the clouds. You know, they've had Flash Gordon on a Hawkman rocket cycle leading them. Why do Hawkmen need rocket cycles? They've got them. I don't know, mate. But, I mean, if one wing's damaged, they can, like, use that. But, like, Flash lures the war rocket through the clouds. And, of course, they're all waiting there. And once it comes through, down they go. By the way, listen to this. That playful sort of... This is Dale Arden. She's got one of the servant girls drunk, and now she's doing some acrobatics and taking the guns off them gas masked sort of stormtroopers and shooting them down. Listen to this. Cello. And harp. Do, 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 do. That's Howard Blake there. Playful boisterousness. And where was I? Oh yeah, so they lure the war rocket through, and of course all the amassed Hawkmen are there in the skies waiting for them. Dive! So in different like waves they dive down. And of course they built the huge, like full-size War Rocket Ajax with its big wing and all that. And all these Hawkmen descend on it. Day one of filming that. Hundreds and hundreds of Hawkmen in the air on wires, you know, swinging down. Most of them fell off the wing, couldn't get up. They'd land awkwardly, they couldn't get up because of the wings, they fly off the other end of the wing. So no fighting took place. And the next day Brian Blessed comes down, and he ruined the day's shooting by landing there after this painstaking setup, and with his cardboard bazooka ray gun, he's going pew 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 pew. It's one of his favourite anecdotes, so forgive me for telling you all again. Brian, cut, Brian! We put in the sound effects. He also tells a story about like training with the stuntmen on for that particular sequence, where you see him, he'll punch a few, he's got that war club, and he'll whack a few of them on the head, and all that kind of shit, mate. But one stuntman said, "Oh, you know, if you punch me in the stomach, I'm not going to double up. You know, that won't happen. It doesn't happen that way." And he's like, "Oh, yes, we'll see about that, won't we?" So when it comes to the scene, it totally gets him in the guts. And you do see it, the guy's, whoa! The guy goes, that, and that's, got you, little bastard, you know. So Brian, God love you. And he's still going strong now. Brian doesn't know when to shut up, does he? You know, he's doing everything. He's on every TV show. He's still you've got to watch him, though, because he's a rogue. You know, he pinches women's bums. You know, he's an old school guy, and he swears like a trooper. And he just does not know when to shut up, when to stop. But he's a hero and a character of our times, and we need him. My God, we need a Flash then, but we need Brian Blessed now. And so it's all great stuff. But and of course Nero gets hit. And he's the old guy with that big crooked nose. His nose turns about several angles, and he's putting the mine on the Ajax war rocket to blow it open so he can get inside. But of course he gets shot, and he lands there, and Flash goes to rescue him. Like, and he goes, "Nero, are you alright?" He goes, "You just winged me." "You winged me." Oh, it's boss stuff. You can see how it's a riot of a movie. It's a miracle, really, that it hangs together as well as it does. You understand all these characters. You understand what they're about, where they're from. Ming is just, you know, a ten a penny, generic, tyrannical twat. You know, in every movie, he's profiled just on a distant moon. He's just, what is he after? Who cares? Who cares? He's having fun doing it. Clitus, Peter Wingard, is just fabulous. You know? Although I do question his judgment, his strategy, when Sky Palace, where the Hawkmen live, which of course is a blueprint for Cloud City, Bespin Cloud City, and you've had Baron and Flash fighting on that disc, which by the way wasn't, they hadn't completed it. It looks great in the movie, but they painted it silver constantly, so each time the guys got up at take up the tape, they had to wipe them down, they had silver paint all over them. So that must have been an arduous process just filming that. It looks great on camera, it looks great, the choreography of the fight there. I think it's a great set piece. But Flash saves Baron's life, so there they are, the olive branch has been extended, and now everyone's friends. Let's go and fight Ming. And Voltan's still like, oh, I don't know about this, you know, but you don't like him either. Oh, and, it, oh. And then, of course, Ming flies past and drops off Clitus to, you know, to go and, like, you know, what the hell? I want them back. I want these prisoners back. What's going on? But Clitus is there on his own. You know, this is a hostile environment. Is it any wonder that he gets picked up and hoisted onto the bed of spikes himself? And all his eyes and his mouth, his tongue ooze out of this gold origami face mask. It is wonderful. Wonderful stuff. Yeah. But again, it's the score I really wanted to address. The fact that a composer could work so well with an established and high-profile rock band, and their particular brand of carnival rock really works so well with a camp, garish, gaudy, day-glow, sci-fi, camp, kitsch adventure. Because their sort of anthemic style and their crazed sort of lyrics and their storytelling, you know, and the fact that they put on theatrical productions, it all goes totally in cahoots with this movie. So it's, did Mike Hodges become completely swayed by Brian May or Freddie Mercury? Was it them that actually became the powerhouse that steered this very wayward ship? I don't know. I think they had a lot of clout on this movie. And of course, they thought that they would then go on to getting a lot more movie scores. And although their music's played in a lot of movies, it really is only Highlander that they got afterwards. I mean, and that is, you know, another story, of course, like working great with Michael Kamen. But Flash Gordon is the one. It also defined for a generation, a new generation of kids, the sound of Queen. So Queen very tactically, you know, brought in a whole new fan base. They had all, you know, the progressive rock and the glam rock and the fans from the 70s who took them on board and went with them. And then they got on a whole new, absolute massive wide audience, global wide audience of kids who love Flash Gordon. Win-win. So you'd wonder why it never happened, but of course they'd actually delayed, I think, a tour and another album at the time to do the Flash Gordon soundtrack. So everything was delayed. So it, perhaps one of their biggest, most influential successes being Flash Gordon was actually also a reason why they didn't get on to do more and more music for movies. And then they applied themselves back into, like, stage acts, live concerts, and, you know, big studio albums. But it is. There's so much to Flash Gordon. To people that write it off, and I don't think I know anyone that does write it off, but I've seen, when you read reviews of Flash Gordon, many people, many critics just go, oh, this was panned when it came out. It was, by half the review ship. The other half loved it, saw it for what it was, a space-borne panto. It's exactly what it is. And gave it plaudits for that. But the film made money, it was a success. You know, it's just that all the trouble behind the scenes kind of meant that you weren't going to get any more, because nobody involved with it wanted to do any more. They've had enough of this. Christ, if this works, you know, it's going to be a miracle. Well, it was a miracle. But the cult status, see, this is why you shouldn't try to remake it or go on with it, because you could inevitably tarnish what's been I know, there was a TV show, wasn't there? A crippled, only lasted one season before it got axed, new version of Flash Gordon, which came out, I don't know, a few years ago. I never saw it. I heard nothing but absolute vitriol and venom towards it. So I gave it a miss. I think they played a lot with gender in it as well, didn't they, and people's sexual orientation. I know Flash Gordon itself does play around with a lot of things there. There's very definitely an incestuous relationship between Princess Aura and Ming. There is. She's also knocking off, I said this in the other video, she's knocking off everybody. She's just, they put the boar worms on me. What are the boar worms? Oh, to be a boar worm. I know Lelamuti. Like Cletus even says to Ming, because Ming's had it tortured, you know, that's what he wants. And he says, like, yes, we put the boar worms on her. I think she actually enjoyed it, Your Excellency. Strange girl, that. So you've got all this going on, and the over the top riper campery, and of course Flash Gordon becomes, you know, an icon for, you know, gay rights. There you go. But you can see why. You can see exactly why. It's a carnival atmosphere. It's lampooning everything. The entire genre is sent up really brilliantly. There's clearly adoration for Alex Raymond's original storyline, because that it adheres quite fastidiously to that. But it also sees all the elements that, oh, this is ridiculous. Look at the state of me, I've got these big stupid wings on, come on. The football fight, you know. Are your men on the right pills? Maybe you should execute their trainer. And you've got Voltan there, who's like, you know, bang, on the heads and tripping them up. And some of the little multicoloured dwarfs stabbing these guys in their spandex buttocks. It's just, it's ridiculous. Go Flash, go Flash, go. And all this kind of stuff. All ad libs, the whole thing is virtually 1 2-hour long improvisation. 1 2-hour long ad libbing. But we love it. We love it. It's relentlessly enjoyable. And I feel like watching it all over again now. So, from me on Kentucky Mekon, it's Ming, you fool, you look more like Mekon. What's going on? We're not talking Dan Dare, we're talking Flash Gordon. Flash! Ah! You just can't get the staff, can you? Maybe you could volunteer for execution. So folks, that was another sort of extended celebration of Flash Gordon. I do apologise for being slightly under the weather here, but you know, in Flash we trust. So I'll be better soon. More reviews, more magic, meth, masks, mayhem. And in the meantime, and this cosmic day glow in between time, please y'all, take it easy. Be healthy, be happy. Keep it kilted, keep it Celtic. Did I hear Dale then?
Welcome back from the grave.
Oh, no, it's Baron. I'm gonna see you all.